Hello, hello, hello. Happy Sunday afternoon, Facebook friends and other social media friends who have joined us here on this Sunday afternoon. I know it's a sunny Sunday. It's a sunny Sunday in summertime. So if you are joining us in the middle of this afternoon, we appreciate you being here live with us. If you happen to watch this later on replay, we thank you for joining us as well. I hope that you're going to find this to be an informative and inspiring conversation. We have a special guest here with us, but I'll tell you a little bit about who I am in case you're not familiar with me, and then I will introduce you to our special guest, our very special guest, Wanda Lloyd. You are joining me here on my Facebook page. I am Stacey Hawkins Adams. I am a multi-published author, a journalist, an essayist. And it is my pleasure to invite you to my space today to share with you the works, but also the heart and the inspiring life journey of a friend of mine, a longtime mentor of mine, Wanda Smalls Lloyd. And to just set the framework for today's conversation, today we are going to be talking about her memoir, which is an inspiring and a powerful book that looks at her lifetime as a history maker in journalism, as a woman of color who has blazed many trails. I'm going to share her bio with you. But ultimately, we're talking about what we typically talk about in this social media space that I curate. We often speak to women, we talk to women, seeking to empower them, to inspire you around your hopes, your dreams, your successes, to power through challenging times, to support each other, to collaborate. And our guest today, Wanda, is the epitome of that. So let me give you a little bit of background about her. I'm going to put up her website so you can see that. Let's see. Going to put some information up about Wanda. Let's see, that's about her book. And we're going to talk about her book, Coming Full Circle. That's my website if you're not familiar with my work. All right. And Wanda's website is wandaloyd.com. So you can find out some information there. So let me give you a little background. So Wanda Lloyd is a wife, a mother. She's a retired newspaper editor. She is a speaker on topics of race, diversity, and leadership. Wanda grew up in Savannah, Georgia. She attended Spelman College, and from there, she went on to enjoy an esteemed career as an editor at seven daily newspapers, including USA Today, where I met her, and at the Washington Post. She served as executive editor of the Montgomery Advertiser, which is the daily newspaper in Montgomery, Alabama, where she made history as the first African American to hold that top leadership position for several years. And in 2013, she retired from that daily journalism position and from daily journalism, and she returned to Georgia to become department chair and associate professor in the Department of Journalism and Mass Communications at Savannah State University. Well, several years later, in 2016, her alma mater, Spelman College, on whose board she once served, they gave her an honorary doctorate of humane letters. And in 2019, just last year, she was inducted into the National Association of Black Journalists Hall of Fame. Now, Wanda decided soon after that to write her memoir, and we will be discussing today her book, as you see there under in our caption there. She's written a memoir called Coming Full Circle, From Jim Crow to Journalism, and it was published in February of this year. And she and her Spelman classmate, Tina McElroy-Ansah, many of you all may know, is a nationally published author. They are working on a new project together, and she's going to share a little bit about that with us too as part of this conversation. So we're going to launch into our conversation about things that have been her passion: race, diversity, leadership, journalism for sure. We're going to talk about her journey and all those who helped her power through, her allies, her supporters, her mentors. And then there will be an opportunity for you all who are watching with us today to ask questions. So feel free to comment as we go along. We'll check our comment section and we'll make sure that we get your questions answered too. But first of all, I want to say not only welcome to you, Wanda, but happy, happy birthday, because today is actually Wanda's birthday. So she's spending her birthday afternoon with us. So I applaud you for that. I want to
Thank
say
you. We
happy
won't say how
birthday.
many years. That's okay.
Would you say?
We won't say what age, but that's okay.
You're celebrating queendom. That's what we'll say. You're celebrating queendom.
Crazy. I have to correct you on something. We did
Okay.
not do USA Today. I have to correct you because you were a powerful woman long before you graduated from college. And I actually met Stacy at her, I went on her campus to do some work, Jackson State University. And she wanted to be an intern at USA Today. She literally pushed me back into a classroom, closed the door, told me to sit down because she was going to tell me about why she could be an intern at USA Today. So that's
but I was polite. I was polite, right? I was a Southern male.
You were polite. You were very persuasive.
Okay, so I'll give the backstory to that because that may help some young ladies who are watching or older folks. So I had that was my sophomore year in college, and I had interned the summer before at a newspaper in Arkansas. And I was just going through this journalism catalog. Back then, we didn't have the internet as much. And so I was looking for summer internships, and I saw one for USA Today. And it did say you had to be like an upperclassman, I think like a junior or a senior. And I thought, I'm going to apply for it anyway. So I wrote this letter to apply. And I think I got a letter back from you saying, I'm so sorry, you're not old enough or you don't have enough seniority, but thanks anyway. And so then I think I was persistent. And you then said, well, I'm coming to campus, so at least I'll say hello. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think I really wanted that internship.
And it worked. So that's a lesson for all young ladies.
Yeah. I would just always say, and I think you are a model of this too, Wanda, like if there's something that you're really passionate about mm-hmm. and you really feel like you have something to contribute, sometimes there's a wall and you have to climb over it or find a way to go around it. That doesn't mean that's for everything, but certainly things that you're passionate about. So mm-hmm. I feel like that internship at USA Today and meeting you really changed my life trajectory. So that was going to happen. So thank you. Well, happy birthday again. I'm going to launch right in. And so I guess my first question is, you know, like I said, this is really a space, hopefully, that empowers women around leadership and, you know, following their hopes and dreams. And, you know, things don't go right, you keep pushing through, and certainly collaboration. And I feel like you are the epitome of that. So how did Wanda Smalls Lloyd, who grew up in Savannah, Georgia, in a segregated society, become to be? How did you become to be a person? Who are those people who helped you find the confidence to follow your own dreams?
Well, thank you. That's a great question. I read about in my book the fact that I had this village. I grew up around the village of people. Of course, it was family. And I grew up in a family of educated women, which I'm very proud of. In fact, I'm the third generation to attend Spelman College. So even that was remarkable considering there weren't that many women who had even gone to college by the time I got to college. And to have three generations in one family was quite remarkable. But my village included other people, included people in my church who, you know, back in the day, they could tell you to do things or not do things and your parents didn't get mad about it.
Right.
You know, they wanted them to guide you. It certainly included people in my neighborhood. It was a tight-knit neighborhood where people would walk from house to house and sit on the front porch and tell wonderful stories. Some of it would be gossip. Some of it would be true stories. You had to sort of discern what it was. But just listening to them, but also the support they gave, like making sure that every time I had a report card, the neighbor ladies wanted to see the report card. And they wanted to give me little gifts. You know, it might be something that they got from the Five and Dime store. But every now and then they wanted to, if I had good grades, they would do that. In fact, I'll tell one quick story from the book. When I was a freshman in college, I came home from my first break. And my grandmother said, you need to go from house to house and knock on the door and say hello to the neighbor ladies. And I didn't want to do that, but I did. But I said, and so they gave me, sometimes they would take a dollar out of their apron pocket and just put it in my hand. And I went to my grandmother and I said, you know, I don't understand why I have to accept their money. I don't know that we need these dollars. And she said, you don't necessarily need the money, but they invested in you. And they feel very strongly that they helped raise you. They helped educate you. They helped get you to college. And you need to be appreciative of that and just say thank you. So those were the kinds of lessons that I learned as a very young person.
Wow. I love that. And I think there's something that was very similar to my own upbringing. And I just wonder in the climate and the world we live in now where we're so siloed and, you know, it's such an individualistic society. Maybe there's some lessons there as we think about, you know, no one succeeds alone. So like when you went to Spelman and you got your first newspaper job, where did you get your first newspaper job? I'm sure those same women were happy for you. What was your first newspaper
My first job was in Rhode Island. So here's this girl from Georgia going all the way to Rhode Island.
I did
an internship in Rhode Island. That was where I did my internship. And I didn't select that newspaper. I was awarded an internship by an organization called the Dow Jones Newspaper Fund. And they assigned me first to go to Temple University for 3 weeks for a crash course that summer. And then the rest of the summer was in Rhode Island. And when I finished the internship at the end of the summer, the managing editor called me into his office, kind of an evaluation chat, nothing formal. Mm-hmm. And he said, "You did a good job. We really liked having you here. And if when you go back and graduate a year from now, we'd like to offer you a position and a full-time position to come back." And I thought, there's no way in the world I'm going back to Providence, Rhode Island. It probably was too cold. I hadn't been there for the winter yet. But it really was the best opportunity I had. And so I went back for 2 years in Providence. And it was a very good experience.
Wow. Now, were you one of the very few people of color in the newsroom? Or what was the newsroom like back in those days?
I was the only person of color in the newsroom.
So tell us a little bit about that. So you came from an HBCU, historically Black college and university, in Atlanta, Georgia. You go to Rhode Island. You're the only person of color. Did you have to educate them? What did that feel like? Or did you feel like a fish out of water?
Well, I felt like a fish out of water, not just because I was African-American, but also because culturally, geographically culturally, things were just very different. I didn't understand some of the accents, because it was different. I was very quiet because I had never, ever been around white people. Mm. I had gone all the way through segregated schools, through high school. Then I went to an HBCU. I did spend a little time at Temple University that 3 weeks, which really was the first time I had spent any time with white people. But when I got to Providence, I spent 2 years listening. Not even having many conversations. So people would talk. I was on the copy desk, and that's an area where we had a lot of downtime. We would work, and then once that edition was done, we had a few minutes to sit around and, you know, just talk or get a cup of coffee. And I remember people talking about the books they were reading, the meals they were having, the restaurants they were going to, and this was all foreign to me because I had not read. I mean, I had a degree in English, so I had read the classics, but I had not read some of the popular culture books that they had read. I had never heard of some of the writers. I had never heard of some of the Italian dishes that a lot of Italians in Providence, a lot of Portuguese, and I just wasn't familiar with the culture. I also, that summer of my internship, I didn't have a car. I took the bus to work. And so I didn't even see any Black people in the community because I didn't have a way to get around. There were some there. They were kind of in South Providence because was the traditional Black community. So it was a little difficult to navigate those waters as an African-American when I was the only one. And one of only maybe a few handful of women. I probably could count the number of women who were professionals in the newsroom on one hand. There were a couple of people working as dictationists. They took notes from the reporters on the phone, but there were not many women journalists in the newsroom.
Wow. So what made you persevere and thrive? Because then you went on to your next position, which was somewhat of a promotion. How did you navigate that, not be intimidated and, you know, where you were quiet, but you weren't intimidated to the point that you didn't thrive and succeed and impress them? You were still able to do that. So what helped you to do that and power through?
Well, my next position was at the Miami Herald, and I got a phone call. I was not seeking a position. They called me, and they were looking for a copy editor. Specifically, they were looking for an African-American, I'm pretty sure. But the difference was at the Miami Herald and the Knight Company, which owned the Miami Herald at the time. That was before the Knight Ritter Company, which some journalists are familiar with. They were hiring quite a few African-Americans at one time. And we developed what I call a family at the Miami Herald. There were some of us most of us were reporters. I think I was the only editor in the group. But we were able to sort of bounce ideas off of each other. When we had issues with our editors, we could talk about it in a safe space. In my book, I tell a story that we used to have a meeting in the ladies' room sometimes. Reporters would get... they get their stories bounced back to them, or there was there was some cultural issues where I think some of the editors didn't understand what they were trying to do, or they were trying to pigeonhole them in certain areas that the reporters didn't want to be. So we would really lean on each other for support. And then we were also able to celebrate each other's birthdays, and you know, we were all young. We didn't have Thanksgiving off, for example. And so we would have Thanksgiving together. It's a couple of people got married during that time. So we would have a little, you know, a little shower for them. So it was a very supportive group, but we pretty much stuck to ourselves. There probably were 10 of us. So that was a difference from Providence, where I was the only one.
But in Providence, so you were able to still thrive, and you just kind of focused on doing your job. You did it well enough. You got this job at the Miami Herald, which is an extremely respected newspaper. And it sounds like they were committed to diversity at that time, in a way, to bring in so many journalists of color, which I think is meaningful, especially during the time we're living in now, when we have so many companies and really the world at large saying, how can we be better and do better about embracing and being inclusive? So it sounds like they did it in a way where they were overtly bringing in reporters and editor, you as an editor of color, to benefit the newspaper, but it was also beneficial for you all to have each other, which I think is meaningful too.
When I talk to folks about diversity, I use that as a lesson. You cannot successfully call yourself diverse if you have one of each. You know, this is right. This is not Noah's Ark where we had two by two. This is real diversity where you really need to have critical mass of everybody. That reflects your community. You know, it really should reflect your community. And that's really what the Miami Herald was trying to do. I think the only gap that I would have seen at that time is that there was a large Cuban community, and I'm not sure there were a lot of people of Cuban descent who were there at the time. It's very different now, and they are there now. And this was in the 70s, so just to put it in context.
Right. So what, I guess I'm kind of ping-ponging a little bit, because you did choose a career, journalism. Even when I chose journalism in the 90s, there were not a lot of people of color. That was something that you championed as a leader, which we'll talk about. But what made you say, I can be a journalist? You know, there are not a lot of people of color in this field. I'm going to take this internship in Rhode Island. What made you say, what was your drive or your passion and want to do it, and when you didn't have people who looked like you before you doing it?
Well, I was in high school, journalism class in the 11th grade, and I took journalism 1 in 11th grade. At the end of the year, my journalism teacher called me aside and offered me the position of being the editor-in-chief in my senior year. She said she observed that I had leadership skills, that quite a few of the other young people in the class would come to me for story ideas or ideas about who should I talk to, the sources, or just to look over their stories. And so recognizing that leadership in me, she appointed me editor-in-chief my senior year. And by then I had the passion, I had the bug, I had what we call that fire in the belly, and I was pretty sure that journalism would be my life's work. So it really started in high school.
Right, that's great. Kind of same for me, because I had a few people tell me as I was saying I was going to major in journalism, like, oh, that's not a field that we go into. Mm-hmm. But I was so passionate about the writing, I was like, I'm going to figure it out. So I'm glad to hear that.
I went to a college, did not have a journalism major. I majored.
So that's why you majored in English. Okay.
There was no journalism at Spelman. I was able to take a few classes in journalism at a very new program at Clark College, which was across the street, now Clark University. And that really led to me getting that internship, because the professor who was teaching those classes was able to tell me about that internship and prepare me for the test that I had to take.
Great. So I want to quickly go through your other newspapers, and then I want to talk about your work as a leader. So you started out in Rhode Island, you went to the Miami Herald, and then where did you go from there? Name the other papers.
I went to the Atlanta Journal, and I was there only a short time. I became engaged very quickly to a gentleman that I had met in Rhode Island. He was in the Navy. He wasn't from Rhode Island, but he was stationed in Rhode Island. And so I'm happy to say in May, we celebrated our 45th anniversary.
Happy anniversary.
When he asked me to marry him, and I moved, he was in the Washington, D.C. area by that time. He was out of the Navy. And so I moved to Washington. And the interesting thing about I went to the Washington Post. The interesting thing about that is I had gotten several calls from a woman named Elsie Carper, who was the recruiting editor of the Washington Post, over the years. And I kept telling her, no, I didn't want to come to Washington. I didn't want to come. Now I had a reason to come. And so it was easy to get a job at the Washington Post. And I was there for 11 years. I actually spent more time at that newspaper than any other newspaper. And after those 11 years, I went to USA Today, which was almost a brand new paper. It was about 3 years old. And that's really where I started developing the leadership, getting leadership opportunities and developing those leadership skills through lots of training. And so I was promoted a couple of times after I went to USA Today and rose to the position of senior editor at USA Today in the Gannett Company. Then I decided I wanted to come south again. And so I went to the senior leaders in the Gannett Company and told them that I'd like to go to a paper in the south. And I ended up going to the Greenville News in Greenville, South Carolina as managing editor. And that's a lesson for a lot of young people. You know, sometimes you go to the big, big, big company, but sometimes work-life balance means you might want to make a change at some point and do something different and be in a place that's not as, you know, hectic and busy and commuting so far and so much crime and all that. And I did that for a while, and I was really, I loved Greenville, South Carolina, thought I'd stay there forever. And I was asked to go to Vanderbilt University by the Freedom Forum and start a program to train non-traditional students in journalism. And maybe we'll talk about that in a minute. So I left the newsroom and did that for 4.5 years. Then I came back to my last newspaper, which was the Montgomery Advertiser, as executive editor. And so those are my seven newsrooms.
Yeah, that's great. That's a wonderful journey. And you make it sound so easy. But I know that there had to be some lessons learned along the way. I think you are the epitome of a great leader. So I guess my first question is, well, as you were making these transitions, you certainly brought myself along. You mentored me. I can think of two women that I'm still friends with today. Shantae Brown-White, who was a fellow USA Today intern. And then there's Jocelyn Coleman. You connected us when we were both working in Florida at Florida Today newspaper. But you've mentored many women along the way. So what along your trajectory, what made you want to give back and sort of pour into, like, not just give us the internships or the jobs in some cases for other people, but you actively mentored and made sure that we went to the diversity trainings and, you know, had these other opportunities. So tell us a little bit about that piece, and then I'm going to ask about your mentors.
Well, actually, I have a question. I think the driving force for me was that I did not have mentors in journalism early in my career. Even growing up in Savannah, there were no African-Americans and no women journalists that I know of back in the 50s and the 60s. It was all white men that I saw on television, in the news. Now, maybe there was somebody behind the scenes, but I doubt it. There were only male bylines in the newspaper. And I dared to become a daily newspaper journalist without ever knowing a daily newspaper journalist before I did that. And so for me, it was important that some of the pitfalls and obstacles that I might have come across, I wanted to be sure that I was in a position to help people to, you know, sort of navigate those waters without having the pitfalls. You know, I loved, I have to say, giving advice to people like you, people who would receive the advice. And that's very important. I don't mentor people who don't want to be mentored or don't want to take the advice or at least consider the advice. And right. So finding people that who I can invest in was very important to me. But I also did it because the news industry needed it and the numbers were low. There's a whole long story about the Kerner Commission report that showed that in 1968, that the news industry was probably responsible for the unrest in cities after the death, around the time of the civil rights movement up to Martin Luther King's death. And the industry started counting those numbers of people, and those numbers were very low. When they started counting, I think in 1978, we made up 4.5% of all people in newsrooms. Yeah, 11% of the population. And so that kind of drove it for me because I wanted to help improve those numbers, but I also wanted to improve the coverage because you cannot have total accuracy in news, I won't just say newspapers, without reflecting the whole community. And you can't reflect the whole community without having the perspective of people who are like the people in the whole community.
Right. Great. I want to go back to that really quickly, though. So you're saying that they're saying because of the imbalance in diversity mm-hmm. during the civil rights, the original civil rights movement, because I do feel like we're in another mm-hmm. civil rights movement.
Yeah. And that's a shame because we're back where we were.
Right, right. So then they're saying that the lack of diversity actually impacted the civil rights movement in terms of the uprisings yeah, and the yeah. protests.
So here's what the report said. The report said that the news industry was not covering communities of, I won't even say communities of color, it really was African American at that time.
Right.
The largest minority at that time. The news industry was not covering it. Therefore, people were surprised at the plight of African Americans, and they were surprised that African Americans were really rioting at that time and tearing up their own neighborhoods and really demanding change. And so we really are only talking about the riots, not the whole civil rights movement, because the whole civil rights movement was largely nonviolent.
Right.
So we really are talking about from 1967 on. Mm-hmm. And because the media was not adequately covering those communities, just in everyday life, you know, what is the economy like? What is housing like? What are educational opportunities like? Like, what is, you know, what is just the the differences in the socioeconomic levels? The news industry was not covering it. They just just ignored it. And because of that, the rest of the nation was surprised when all these riots came about. And so doesn't that, again, sound like what we're going through right now? What happened after the death of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and, you know, Ahmaud Arbery and all the others?
It does. It does. And I think also what's striking about that is kind of what the next layer of the question was going to be. You had these doors open for you, but you certainly had to have what we are now calling allies. So mm-hmm. folks who didn't look like you, who gave you the chance at the Miami Herald and the Washington Post and USA Today to take you up the ranks to senior editors. So who were those supporters who realized that having a diverse staff and diverse leadership was important, and who were those who supported you in those roles and helped you to thrive?
Well, my first mentor was a gentleman named Ron Martin. Ron Martin was managing editor at the Miami Herald, and he's the one who interviewed me when I came to Miami just to you know, see if I wanted to work there, and they wanted me. And he really supported me during that time, but we really didn't become friends until after I left the Miami Herald, about 18 months after I got there. And then we just kept in touch over the years, and he went to Baltimore as an editor of the afternoon paper. He went to New York, I think, as editor of Us magazine. But we would continue to, he would send me articles, and we would write letters, and we would have phone calls, and we just stayed in touch. And then when I was ready to go to USA Today, he made it possible for me to get there, but he also sent me to some of this training, this amazing training for leaders, the biggest of which was a program, it was an 8-week program at Northwestern University called the Management Training Center, which they called it a mini MBA for newspaper professionals. Mm. He suggested that I go there. And when he gave me the opportunity, I was, my daughter was, maybe 4 years old, and he said, I want you to go to this training for the summer. And I looked at the brochure that he handed me, and I said, I can't do this. And he said, why? And I said, because I have a 4-year-old daughter and a husband who's working and can't take care of her all the time. And I just don't see my way of leaving to go to Evanston, Illinois. And I went home that night, and I said to my husband, guess what Ron wants me to do? And I showed him the brochure, and he said, and my husband said, and by the end of the night, my husband had put together a support system and said, okay, now I have someone to take care of her in the morning before I go to work. Now I have someone to bring her home after school. Now I have my sister who can take care of her sometimes on the weekend. I have someone who can put braids in her hair. I mean, all the little details he worked out, and he said, now, what's the problem? So I was able to go back to Ron Martin and say, yes, I can do this. I can go to this program at Northwestern. So that would have been my mentor. But the other opportunity I had was when I joined the American Society of Newspaper Editors, which Ron urged me to do, and I joined the diversity committee. That's really where I sort of put my imprint on diversity for the industry because I was able to, I chaired the diversity committee for a number of years, and I was able to set up some training programs and bring in speakers for the editors. These are the top editors of every newspaper in the country. So those are the two things that I would say. My mentor and the American Society of Newspaper Editors really made an impact for me so that I can make an impact in the industry.
Right, and your wonderful husband. So that's a great story about his support because that really helped as well. So that's awesome. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to ask you one last question, and not last, but one more question. Then you've got some questions in the comment box, so we'll go to those. So my question segueing to that is, you know, you're a journalist. So as journalists, we typically tell other people's stories. So what led you to write this memoir? What made you want to kind of delve into your own background and be self-reflective and share your story?
When I was at the end of my career, I had the opportunity to come to Savannah, where I live now, and be chair of the Department of Journalism and Mass Communications. And as chair, I needed to have a conversation with every senior before they graduated. And so the seniors in this conversation, we would talk about, you know, whether they were ready to graduate, they had all their credits and all their work was done. But then they would ask me questions about my career because they knew I had not been in the academy a long time. They wanted to know, what did you do? Where did you come from? And as I was telling them stories, they were going, wow, how did you get there? How did you do that? And I started to realize that, wait a minute, I came from Jim Crow and I became a top editor and I worked at some of the biggest newspapers in the country. And I've had these amazing opportunities to travel and to mentor people. And I started thinking about the stories I had to tell. And then into the picture comes my friend, Tina McElroy-Ansa, who was my roommate at Spelman, my freshman year roommate at Spelman College. And I started telling her that some of the students were continuously asking me to tell stories. And I said, you know, I might want to write a book about it someday. And she said, absolutely, you have a story to tell. But it really was several years later before I actually sat down to write. So it had to percolate in me for a while. I left the newsroom. I went to Savannah State. I worked there for a few years, and I didn't really start writing until I retired for the second time. So my family tells me that I have failed retirement 101 several times.
I think you have, because you keep going. You keep inspiring us. So I'm going to look at some of these comments and see if we've got some comments, some questions here for you. We've got hello from Cassie, who's in our writers group. We've got happy birthday from Lisa Overton, who is a friend of mine, and she's your Spelman sister. There's Bonnie Newman Davis. Hey, Bonnie. She says, preaching to my choir, Wanda, even after I have a diverse newsroom. Let's see here. Their travel, restaurant, social life, it was a wake-up call. Yes, internships. We've got a hello from Otisa Miles, and then there's Cassandra, who says, awesome story and happy birthday. So no questions just as of yet, but if any of you all have questions for us, please feel free. Latika says, hi, Savannah native. Another local friend of mine, Latika Lee, she is a fellow Savannah native. So if any of you all have questions for Wanda, feel free to pop those in here. But until you do, I'll ask her a couple more questions and then we're going to wrap up. So we've kind of talked about the mentorship role. We talked about all of that. I think one thing that women struggle with, and I've written about this in fiction, I've had many talks in nonfiction, is when you are succeeding in your dream and you're kind of pursuing those things that, you know, make your heart smile, but then you've got the family or you've got the day job or say you've got something else that you've got to focus on. How do you make all that work? So you were working at some of the top newspapers in the country. I know you touch on this in your book. You referenced your very supportive spouse. You referenced having a four-year-old daughter at the height of your career. How did you balance those things? Make sure you still had a solid family life. You still had time for you, but you still were able to be excellent in your career. So that's, you know, give some advice maybe to our women who are watching and wondering how to make those things happen.
Well, I know that I was very good at that early on. I think I missed some opportunities to be more balanced, especially when our daughter was very young. You know, I didn't, I was not one of those parents who went on field trips with the class because I was working all the time. And I remember when she was in the eighth grade or approaching the eighth grade and her class was going to go to Paris for a few days. And for the first time, I said, I'll be the chaperone. So eighth grade to realize. And then I really enjoyed being around them. But
I don't think I did that well. She was really good at basketball, and I didn't go to her early games. And somewhere in middle school, I decided to go to a game. I think it was the last game of the season. And I walked into the gymnasium, and all I could hear was someone, people shouting, "Give Shelby the ball, Shelby, give Shelby the ball, rebound, Shelby, Shelby's real." And I went, "Whoa, why is everybody calling my child's name?" And I realized that she was really, really, really good in basketball. And so then I decided that I was going to go to every game I could in high school, and I did. I don't know that I missed more than two games the entire time she played basketball. So it really took me a while to come to that. And so I would say advice for young people who are balancing work and life is, you know, the work goes on whether you're there or not. There were some situations where I really put my own health in jeopardy because I continued to work, and I didn't take care of myself. And I wish that I had done a better job. I saw some signs that I should have seen. I found out after my mother died, I was trying to balance taking care of a mother who had cancer and working full time. I don't think I did the best job that I could in that regard, but I realize that now. So really take care of yourself. That's the thing that I would say first. Take care of your family. And I think we're in a better place now. I think we're in a place where hopefully more supervisors recognize that we all have to do a better job with work-life balance. In fact, I've had some men who work with me say, "I wish I had done a better job. I wish I had gotten to know my own kids better because I left it up to my wife and other members of the family, and I just worked real quick." And you know what we tried to do? We tried to emulate the men. We tried to work like the men. Now I always tell people, I work like a man, but I still want to be a lady.
Right.
And that's important. So I think men are now recognizing that we need an equal role in work-life balance and running our families and things like that.
So what would you say to folks in the two pandemics? We've got the global health pandemic. We've got the racial social justice pandemic. I consider it happening at this time. And so a lot of people are feeling stuck or paralyzed or don't even know how to consider next steps just because so much is going on and it's changing daily. How have you powered through those difficult times? I think as an editor, probably the recession was one of those times. Right. You're certainly in the middle of a national book tour during these two pandemics. So how have you been able to take a deep breath with everything that's going on, but still also focus on what your purpose is?
Well, I call it my re-retirement. Now it's re-retirement. So I don't have to worry about going out of the house very often. And I had to remake myself because you're right. I was on a national book tour. It was planned all the way through November. I had travel planned. And then it took me maybe 3 or 4 weeks of staying at home at the beginning of the stay-at-home orders and thinking about, instead of feeling sorry for myself, and thinking that my book was going to just be a flop, it took me a while to just think about, well, how can I make it work? I've got to learn some new technology. And I've always been good at technology and appreciated it, but I really had to learn how to do some things in a different way, like we all have. I mean, who heard of Zoom before? Somebody did, but not a lot of us heard of it before the pandemic. And now on 2, 3, 4 Zooms a day, actually 3 today. Plus a church thing on YouTube. And so I'm remaking myself. And I'm having to think about, well, who am I? What is it I want to do? I want to get the word out about my book. I want to be a voice in this era of Black Lives Matter / anti-racism because I have something to say. I want to spend more time at home, and I'm enjoying that. I'm actually very happy that I'm not jumping on planes and sleeping in, strange hotel beds every 3 or 4 nights a week. And so I'm appreciating what I have, and I'm taking care of me. As far as powering through when I was an editor, a couple of the big things that I had to power through, one was when we had hurricanes in Montgomery, Alabama, and figuring out how to support the staff and keep the operation moving. What are the things we have to do to be sure that first the staff goes home and they make sure they secure everything, and if they have to send their family away to a safe place or if they have to bring their family into the newsroom, and we made accommodations for things like that. So planning was really important in terms of powering through. And once you have a plan, you just work the plan, and then you can sit back and relax and have some pizza and drink, you know, stale coffee for 3 or 4 days and sleep on the floor in the office in a sleeping bag and just, you know, make it work. That's, and the recession was one of the crises that I had to power through. And that was years of powering through, because we had layoffs, which I had to oversee. The, you know, the corporation told us to cut our budget, cut our budget. And every time they called for layoffs, I had to figure out who was going to lose their job. And that was very painful for me. In fact, ultimately, I think it was the thing that convinced me that it was time to retire, because I just got to a point where I was physically ill every time I did that, and I decided I wasn't going to do it anymore.
Wow, that is tough. That is tough. So I guess my last two questions, oh, let's see, we've got a couple in the chat box before I go to mine. Let's see what these comments are. You got a happy birthday from Rita. And then you do have a question here from, again, your Spelman sister, Lisa Overton. Lisa says, what advice would you give to young adults as they pursue their dream and they just can't seem to get that right opportunity to move them to the next level? So few opportunities these days are available for young adults.
Well, you know, I feel for young people these days, because it's not like in the old days when you and I started and we said, oh, we can just work for one organization or one industry for the rest of our careers if we want to. We don't always want to do that. Now, you know, there was a study several years ago that said that most millennials would have 5 jobs or 5 different careers in their work life. And I really believe that. And so one piece of advice I would say, if things aren't working for you in one place, maybe it's time to move on. And I think that may have been some advice I gave you a number of years ago. If it's not working, just, you know, sometimes you just have to move up or move aside. And I tell young people, including my own daughter, sometimes a lateral move is just as good as an upward move. And
right.
So think about that, because in fact, I took a step down once in my career. When I left USA Today and went to the Greenville News, I would not have considered it a total promotion. And I certainly gave up some money, but I thought, okay, I can live on less money because I'm moving from Washington, D.C. to Greenville, South Carolina. And so things like, so you have to think about, weigh all those things and think about what's important to you in terms of remaking yourself and whatever your next step in your career is. And I think also that a lot of us, and I include myself in this, are gonna, and you too, are going to work for ourselves. And so we've got to figure out how to do that.
Right, and be nimble, probably, I would say. Like you said, it's not one, if this isn't working, maybe shift to the other thing. And especially as young people, maybe it's not the one thing. Maybe you're doing 3 things at once to create one thing. Yeah. So I guess my final 2 questions, unless others pop up in the comment box, just wondering, like, what is your takeaway? What do you want folks to take away from the book? And in the book, you talk about having the seat at the table. So those are the kind of my 2 final questions about, you know, you mentioned having the seat at the table in your prologue and in your epilogue. And in addition to that, what do you want people to take away from reading your book?
Well, the seat at the table is really important because it's a place of power, or at least it was for me. It was a place where I could make an imprint and have an impact on the newspaper, on the industry, as well as on the people who worked for us. Having a seat at the table means moving up into the organization till you get to a point where you're in the meetings where decisions are being made. And that for me was my goal. I wanted to be in a place where decisions were made. So I wrote about that at the beginning of my book, because I told the story just about meeting a guy in church who saw me sitting at the table on C-SPAN one day. And he was amazed at the power I had, because I was running the news meeting at USA Today. And these are his words: with all those white folks around you, because that was the staff. It was me and a bunch of white folks. But there were some other people of color, but not necessarily at the table on that day that they were filming C-SPAN. And then at the end, I talked about what I just said, the impact that you can have overall. I forgot the other part of your question. I'm sorry.
The other part was just, you know, so yeah, the seat at the table is so important. And then overall, what do you want people to take away from reading your book? Yes, it's sort of a book about journalism, but it's really more about diversity and leadership.
You know, I there are four themes in the book. One is history, and I call it history slash family. Mm-hmm. It's about growing up in a period of time when things were very different. And I try to tell some of that history because I thought it was important to put my life and my career in the context of that history. And of course, family played into that. Journalism, of course, is one of the themes. And I tried to tell some stories about journalism, not only to tell the stories, but to enlighten people about the process of journalism. And I think that's very relevant today because people are now trying to understand, well, what is a journalist? You know, even before the pandemic and the Black Lives Matter movement, you know, because of the political climate we're in, people are talking about journalism and what and the relevance of journalism. One of the themes is leadership, clearly leadership, because that was my path. And the other theme is diversity, because it was so important for me to address the issues of diversity and very fulfilling that I had an impact on diversity.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, I do hope folks will visit your website. The book is also available on Amazon and on anywhere books are sold. It's a nationally distributed book. But certainly if you want a signed copy from Wanda, visit her website to get that. And then Wanda, will you tell us a little bit more about what your next project is? Because as you said, you're like in your third iteration of retirement. And so you've got your website, WandaLloyd.com. They can get your current book. But what are you working on next?
Well, you know, I was working on a proposal to do something on leadership for young women. And then I was having conversations after the death of George Floyd. I was having conversations with friends, who are white women for the most part, who were calling me and saying, I had no idea that things like this were going on. I had no idea that Black people were being discriminated against to this extent, or that the police were as violent against Black people as we see now in the case of George Floyd. And the collection of all the people, collection is not a good word, but all the Black people who had been harmed by police, there were people who were truly hurt, well-intentioned white people who were truly hurt and wanted to know, what can I do? You know, they're saying to me, I'm too old, I'm not gonna get out there and I'm not gonna march. I'm not going out there in the age of COVID. I gotta stay home, but what can I do? And so I realized that people were calling me and asking my advice about this. And I was having a conversation with my friend, Tina McElroy-Onsdale, who wrote the foreword to my book, and my longtime friend, more than 50 year friend. And we were just having the same, and she was having the same conversations with white friends. And we don't live in the same city. She lives in St. Thomas Island, Georgia, and I live in Savannah. And we started talking about, what can we do? And so we came up with this idea to do a book, and we are doing, it's an anthology. And so we're having other women contribute to this book, and it's called Meeting at the Table, African-American Women Write on Race, Culture, and Community. And we have some amazing women who are contributing to this book, some of whom when you see the book, you will recognize their names, and then some who are equally as amazing, who are kind of new to the mainstream writing world, who are going to tell some of their stories. They're going to talk about their passions. They're going to talk about their careers. They're going to talk about their communities. They're going to talk about their cultural, some of their culture. And they're going to help people understand that and then give people some solutions. Those who want solutions on how can I help, how can I make life better for all of us.
That's awesome. And what is your planned publication date for that?
Well, our planned publication date, we're doing this really quickly, and Tina has her own publishing company called Down South Press. And so we plan to have it out in November.
That's awesome and perfect timing. And it sounds like it's going to help a lot of people. So that's wonderful. So you may be back, or maybe you and some of your guest authors can come back and celebrate the power of women's stories with us with that. So with that, any parting thoughts? Actually, wait a minute. I think we've got one more comment before we sign off. Let's see. That's Lisa again saying, thank you so much for sharing, for this opportunity to spend some time with you. Thank you, Lisa. We appreciate you.
I remember you, Lisa.
Great. Thank you, Lisa. Any parting thoughts, Wanda? I know we want them to visit your website, wandaloyd.com. If they want to follow you on social media, which I do recommend, it's Wanda Smalls Lloyd. So you can find her there on her Facebook page. She'll be updating you on this new project with Tina that she's mentioned. She's often interviewed on national and international platforms. So you can follow her there. Anything else you want to add, Wanda?
Well, I just want to thank you for the opportunity, and I would love to have readers go to my book and then come to my website, give me some feedback, but also I'm open to having conversations. I really want to start a national dialogue where I can have conversations about race, and so I'm happy to talk to small groups or large groups about that, and that's what I spend a lot of my time doing every week, so I'm happy to receive those invitations.
Wonderful. I hope you all who are watching this either live with us, thank you for joining us live. Thank you for those who will watch later. Please feel free to comment in the comment section where you're watching, and also certainly reach out to Wanda. She's excellent, as you can hear. I'm biased. She's been my mentor for more than 25 years, so I'm keeping her, I think. Well, happy birthday again, Wanda. Thank you for joining us, and thank you again to everyone who chimed in with us. This has been Stacey Hawkins Adams, celebrating the power of stories, and I hope that you will do something today to celebrate your own story. Take care and enjoy your day.